The brook gave Adam's ale of unsurpassed crystal. For the rest, there was a certain sauce, compounded of fresh air and appetite of youth, which gave to everything a divine flavor. To sit in Rainbow Valley, steeped in a twilight half gold, half amethyst, rife with the odors of balsam fir and woodsy growing things in their springtime prime, with the pale stars of wild strawberry blossoms all around you, and with the sough of the wind and tinkle of bells in the shaking treetops, and eat fried trout and dry bread, was something which the mighty of earth might have envied them. "Sit in," invited Nan, as Jem placed his sizzling tin platter of trout on the table. "It's your turn to say grace, Jem."
"I've done my part frying the trout," protested Jem, who hated saying grace. "Let Walter say it. He likes saying grace."
"And cut it short, too, Walt. I'm starving." But Walter said no grace, short or long, just then. An interruption occurred. "Who's coming down from the manse hill?" said Di. End of chapter 3. Chapter 4. The Manse Children. Aunt Martha might be, and was, a very poor housekeeper. The Reverend John Knox Meredith might be, and was, a very absent-minded, indulgent man. But it could not be denied that there was something very homelike and lovable about the Glen St. Mary manse, in spite of its untidiness. Even the critical housewives of the Glen felt it, and were unconsciously mellowed in judgment because of it. Perhaps its charm was in part due to accidental circumstances, the luxuriant vines clustering over its gray, clabbered walls, the friendly acacias and balm of Gileads that crowded about it with the freedom of old acquaintance, and the beautiful views of harbor and sand dunes from its front windows. But these things had been there in the reign of Mr. Meredith's predecessor, when the manse had been the primmest, neatest, and dreariest house in the Glen. So much of the credit must be given to the personality of its new inmates.